bwenzi la tu Yesu atikonda konda fe tipunzitse buye Yesu tikondane na nutu tisaiwali
Yeah.
konda fe tipunzitse buye Yesu tikondane nanutu tisaiwalire ose wenzila tu dinutu ji Jesus. ati konda konda fe tipunzitse buye Yesu tikondane nanu tu tisaiwalire kose wenzila tu dinu tu chikondano
chikondano chake chi
chikondano
chikondano chake
chi Wednesday. la tu Yesu ati konda konda fe tipunzitse buye Yesu ti kondane na nutu disaiwali
Cheers.
bwenzi la tu Yesu ati konda konda fe tipunzitse buye Yesu tikondane na nutu tisaiwali
I request you to maintain your seats as the bridal party comes in, but I'll ask you to stand when the bride herself marches in. As a sign of respect, it's all about these two people. Okay, if we're ready, bridal party.
To my dearest friend on earth, there's no way to tell your worth. I could sail the distant sea and still be lonely. God said it's not good for man to be alone. I believe that you're my one and only. So come with me. You'll see when the sun is shining. When the leaves are falling for you. When the winter comes, keep you warm, carry you through. Springtime love, carry you through. Springtime love. When our lives begun, when we became one, seasons come and go, but my love for you does flow. And the grace of God who gave his life to you, I give mine. I give my all. When the sun is shining, climb the mountain. When the leaves are falling you warm, I'll carry you through springtime love and sunny shine. When the leaves are falling, keep you warm, I'll carry you through springtime love. Carry you through springtime love when our lives begun. When the leaves have fallen, when the winter comes, I'll carry you through springtime love. I'll carry you through a springtime love. When our lives begun, we became one. Sail the distant sea, still be lonely. God said it's not good for man to be alone. I believe that you're my one and only.
So come. Thank you very much. Bride is about to march in. Let me ask the congregation to stand. Friends, we meet today in God's presence on this joyful and solemn occasion to witness the marriage of Chisengele Chibuta to Tukiya, Eva Maria Liywalii. The church and congregation here at Lusaka Baptist Church share in the joy of these two happy people, their families, and their friends as they take their vows one to the other and as they seek God's continuing blessing upon their union in years to come. The Bible in Genesis chapter 2, verses 18 to 25 teaches us that marriage is God's gift given at creation, at the time of man's original perfection. It is written, "The Lord God said, it is not good for man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable to him." And that for this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and they will become one flesh. Further, it is God's purpose that as husband and wife give themselves to each other in love throughout their lives, they shall be united in love as Christ is united to his church. Marriage is not to be entered into carelessly, lightly, or selfishly. Rather, it is to be entered into responsibly, thoughtfully, and in the fear of God, having in mind the reasons why marriage was given. And these are the reasons. Number one, it was ordained for the lifelong companionship, joy, help, and comfort, which husband and wife should give to each other. Secondly, it was given so that with delight and tenderness, they may know each other in love, and that through the joy of their bodily union, they may strengthen the union of their hearts and lives. Thirdly, it was ordained so that any children they might have can be brought up in a secure home, nurtured and trained in godliness. For it was given for the good of society, which can only be strong and prosperous where the marriage bond is held in the highest honor. And lastly, in the Bible, marriage is shown to be a beautiful picture of the sacred union between Christ and his church. It is into this estate that these two persons here come now to be joined. I'd like us to sing. Well, maybe before that, let's pray together. Shall we pray? Our Father in heaven, we thank you for what is taking place this morning as we see the coming together in holy matrimony of our two friends. We pray, dear Father, that you'll be specially present in our midst this morning, and that indeed the picture that we are seeing developing before our very eyes will be one which would truly display the union that exists between the Lord Jesus Christ and his church. Bless Chisengele, bless Tukiya as they take this very important step. Bless us also, dear Father, as we seek to celebrate with them, but also indeed to encourage them along the way. Thank you very much. Shall we sing our first hymn, number 734, "He Leadeth Me"? If you don't have the hymn book, it will be beamed on the wall. Thank you very much. You may take your seats. Now, marriage is a way of life created and blessed by God. That's Chisengele and Tukiya are now to begin. They will each consent to the other. They will join hands and exchange solemn vows, and as a sign of their vows, they will each give and receive a ring. Wherefore, if anyone can show a just cause why this couple may not be lawfully joined in marriage, please declare it now, or forever be silent. Thank you very much. That's a sign that we can proceed. Chisengele, if you can be upstanding and draw near him. Thank you very much. I require and charge you both in the sight of God that if either of you know any just cause why you may not be joined together in marriage, that you do now confess it. Thank you very much. I've seen the way they have looked at me with that determination. Everything is in order. Chisengele, as you come near me, I would like you to repeat after me. I do solemnly declare,
I do solemnly declare
that I know not of any lawful impediment,
that I know not of any lawful impediment,
why I, Chisengele Chibuta,
why I, Chisengele Chibuta,
may not be joined in matrimony,
may not be joined in matrimony,
to Tukiya Liywalii,
to Tukiya Liywalii.
Thank you very much. Tukiya, repeat after me as well. I do solemnly declare,
I do solemnly declare
that I know not of any lawful impediment,
that I know not of any lawful impediment,
why I, Tukiya Liywalii,
why I, Tukiya Liywalii,
may not be joined in matrimony,
may not be joined in matrimony,
to Chisengele Chibuta,
to Chisengele Chibuta.
Thank you very much. Chisengele, will you take Tukiya Liywalii to be your wedded wife, to live together according to God's holy ordinance of marriage? Will you love her, comfort her, honor and keep her in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, cling only to her as long as both of you shall live?
I will.
Tukiya. Tukiya, will you have Chisengele Chibuta to be your wedded husband, to live together according to God's holy ordinance of marriage? Will you love him, comfort him, honor and keep him in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, cling only to him as long as both of you shall live?
I will.
Who has the honor of presenting this woman to be married to this man?
Myself, Mr. Liywalii.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Please hand her over to him. Thank you. Thank you so much. If you are here in front of them, you see their smiles. Very happy. Chisengele, please repeat after me your wedding vows to Tukiya. I call upon all these people here.
I call upon all these people here
to witness that I, Chisengele Chibuta,
to witness that I, Chisengele Chibuta,
do take you to Tukiya Liywalii.
Do take you to Tukiya Liywalii
to be my lawful wedded wife.
To be my lawful wedded wife.
According to God's holy ordinance.
According to God's holy ordinance.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better, for worse.
For better, for worse.
For richer, for poorer.
For richer, for poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
According to God's holy word.
According to God's holy word.
Until death us do part.
Until death us do part.
And to that end.
And to that end.
I give you my promise.
I give you my promise.
Tukiya. I call upon all these people here.
I call upon all these people here.
To witness that I.
To witness that I.
Tukiya Liywalii. Do take you, Chisengele Chibuta.
Do take you, Chisengele Chibuta.
To be my lawful wedded husband.
To be my lawful wedded husband.
According to God's holy ordinance.
According to God's holy ordinance.
To have and to hold.
To have and hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better, for worse.
For better, for worse.
For richer, for poorer.
For richer, for poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
According to God's holy word.
According to God's holy word.
Until death us do part.
Until death us do part.
And to that end.
And to that end.
I give you my promise.
I give you my promise.
Thank you very much. I believe that a couple has rings to exchange to each other. I would like you to face each other. Thank you very much. So before that happens, let me just make a statement about the wedding ring. So the wedding ring is a symbol of eternity. It is an outward sign of an inward and spiritual bond which unites two hearts in endless love. And now, as a token of your love and of your deep desire to be forever united in heart and soul, you, Chisengele, may place a ring on the finger of your bride. Even as you repeat after me. Tukiya.
Tukiya.
I give you this ring.
I give you this ring.
As a sign of our marriage.
As a sign of our marriage.
With my body, I honor you.
With my body, I honor you.
All that I am, I give you.
All that I am, I give you.
And all that I have, I share with you.
And all that I have, I share with you.
In the name of God.
In the name of God.
Father.
Father.
Son.
Son.
And Holy Spirit.
And Holy Spirit.
With this ring.
With this ring.
I thee wed.
I thee wed.
Thank you very much. Tukiya, you can do the same. Chisengele.
Chisengele.
I give you this ring.
I give you this ring.
As a sign of our marriage.
As a sign of our marriage.
With my body, I honor you.
With my body, I honor you.
All that I am, I give to you.
All that I am, I give to you.
And all that I have, I will share with you.
All that I have, I will share with you.
In the name of God.
In the name of God.
Father.
Father.
Son.
Son.
And Holy Spirit.
And Holy Spirit.
With this ring.
With this ring.
I thee wed.
I thee wed.
Thank you. Thank you very much. For as much then as Chisengele Chibuta and Tukiya Liywalii have given their consent and made their marriage vows to each other and have witnessed the same before God and these witnesses, and thereto have pledged their faithfulness each to the other, and have pledged the same by the giving and receiving each of a ring by the authority vested in me as an officer of the law in the Republic of Zambia and a minister of the gospel in the Church of Christ, I pronounce that these two happy people are husband and wife together. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, what therefore God has joined together, let no man put asunder. Please stand and face each other. Well, there was a lot happening. That's just a small sample of what you've seen. Chisengele, please unveil Mrs. Chibuta. Chisengele and Tukiya, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you his peace. Amen. We're going to pray for the couple, and I think we can bring those two chairs forward. I also ask the elders of Lusaka Baptist Church that are present this morning to come forward so that we pray for Tukiya and Chisengele. Let me ask Mr. Ibajene to pray for Tukiya and Chisengele.
Thank you. Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you for this glorious day, the day you ordained that Chisengele and Tukiya should become husband and wife. It is in your pleasure, according to your will, that you brought this to happen. And Lord, truly it's marvelous in our eyes. We have seen them grow from little children to the point when you brought them into faith in your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, and now entering into holy matrimony. Lord, we are so grateful, our hearts overflowing. Lord, it's a new phase of life for them, never been trod this way, and therefore commend them to your grace. You have married them. We pray that you might walk with them this journey to the very end. That, Lord, they will look to you day by day. They will call upon the name of the Savior day by day, that he may be the center of this marriage. They may worship him together. They may seek him together. That, Lord, be blessed because they are children. Father, we pray that may bless them, even with children, pleases you, Lord. It'll be a family, a joyful family, a family where there's great harmony and love and care and kindness to each other. So we pray that, Lord, we please you, even as that blessing was pronounced upon them, to be real and true upon their lives, all the days of their lives. This we ask through the name of your Son, our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Thank you very much. Could I ask the congregation to stand so that we sing together another hymn, 615. 615. Come thou fount of every blessing.
Sings of mercy never ceasing, all for songs of loudest praise.
Thank you very much. We may take our seats. At this point in time, let me ask Mr. Ibajene to come and share from God's word.
Good morning, everyone. And it's my great joy and privilege to be the first to say congratulations to Chisengele and Tukiya. We thank God that finally he has brought you to this very moment in your lives when your love is being consummated in this day. A wedding is always a wonderful event, more so for a Christian wedding, such as we're just witnessing this morning between Chisengele and Tukiya, because it points us to a greater wedding, a more glorious wedding, a final wedding that will take place at the end of time. The Bible calls it the marriage supper of the Lamb. And in the book of Revelation, we're given a vision of that wedding, which indeed was given to Apostle John on the land of Patmos. And I want us to reflect a little bit this morning concerning that vision of the wedding of the Lamb. So reflect together from Revelation chapter 19, verse 6 to 10. I'll read those verses. They say, "And I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude, as the sound of many waters, and as the sound of mighty thunderings, saying, Hallelujah, for the Lord God omnipotent reigns. Let us be glad and rejoice and give him glory. For the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. And to her was granted to be arrayed in fine linen, clean and bright. For the fine linen is the righteous acts of the saints." Then he said to me, "Write, blessed are those who are called to the marriage supper of the Lamb." And he said to me, "These are the true words of God." The Bible indeed is the most wonderful book. It tells us how things started and how they will also end. Human history began with a wedding in the Garden of Eden, when God brought Eve to Adam. And basically, literally, God married that couple, the very first couple, that first wedding. Yet, from the scriptures, again, we see that actually at the end of history, there will be another wedding, the marriage supper of the Lamb, as we've read from this chapter 19 of Revelation. That wedding will not only be the last one, now they will also end, but it will usher in a totally new way of life with a wedding. Getting some echo. There will be a new heaven and a new earth ushered in where only righteousness dwells. So that last wedding will end history as we know it today, usher in a new era of only righteousness and holiness going forward in the kingdom of God. So this morning, as I already said, we'd like to reflect briefly on that last wedding, the marriage supper of the Lamb. However, before I do that, I just want us to appreciate something of the Jewish custom regarding marriage in those days of the Lord Jesus Christ. They had three distinct stages to a marriage or to a wedding. The first stage was actually the signing of a marriage contract. In our time, we do it the reverse. Very soon, these two young people will be signing the marriage certificate. But in those olden days, it was actually the first thing to be done. So that contract was signed between the parents of the bride and the bridegroom, or sometimes parents of the bride and the bridegroom himself. It was, of course, followed then by payment of a dowry, or lobola, as we call it here. This step commenced a process of called betrothal. So the couple signed a contract through their parents, expressing that deep commitment to each other, and effectively the marriage, as it were, sealed, even before the wedding took place. Today we can relate this to an engagement. There's an account, for example, in the Gospels about Mary and Joseph. Before they came together, the Bible says, Mary was found to be with child of the Holy Spirit. And it is said that Joseph, the husband to Mary, before they came together, he was already called a husband to Mary. Why? Because that contract had already been signed. Mary was betrothed to Joseph. That had been sealed. She was, in other words, pledged to be married to Joseph, only waiting for the right time to happen. So Joseph could rightly be called the husband to Mary. And that we find in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 1, verse 18 and 19. So before they were wedded, because they had signed the contract, that marriage was as good as being sealed. Now the second step, which happened about a year later, was what was really more or less like a parade taking place in the night. In fact, at midnight, the bridegroom with his friends, or you might call them best men, with their torches would march to the home of the bride at midnight. Of course, the bride was aware they were coming, so she too was ready with her maids. The torches also, they had them as well. And so the groom and his friends arrived, and the idea was to take that bride with him back to his home, or his parents' place. So they marched back together and then ushered in the next stage, which I'll come to in a moment. So that parable we find in the book of Matthew, for example, about 10 virgins. Five were foolish, five were wise, is a reflection of that culture, that they were waiting for the bridegroom to come with his friends at midnight. Some didn't have their lamps ready, others had. So the foolish didn't have their lamps ready. So they were left out. They couldn't go. Then, of course, the final stage was now the marriage itself. When that group of groom, bride, and their friends arrived at the groom's home, then the whole celebration started. And it took days. If you recall again from the account of Scripture, John chapter 2, the Lord Jesus Christ being at a wedding at Cana, it says on the last day they ran out of wine. There have been several days of celebration. The last day came, there was no wine. And so Christ made wine as they approached him through the mother. Indeed. So that was the culture. Three stages: contract signing, a parade to bring the bride to the groom's home, and then the wedding celebration itself that lasted a few days. So having appreciated somewhat of that culture, let's just reflect a bit about the marriage supper of the Lamb this morning. And I want us to just think about four things concerning that marriage supper of the Lamb. Firstly, it says, blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. So there'll be those who'll be invited to the last supper of the Lamb, the marriage of the Lamb. Not everyone will be there. Not everyone will be there. Now, of course, a few weeks ago, most of us must have received cards, invitation cards, concerning this wedding. I received one through the parents, through Chisengele. You felt honored to receive a card to the wedding, because after this, there'll be reception, there'll be celebration, there'll be eating and feasting, as it were, and so on. And but if you don't have a card, I'm sure they won't allow you at the reception. It's limited in number, space, and so on. Well, you see, in a human reception situation, sometimes people can actually sneak in, what we call get crashing. You know, they might go and explain themselves away, no, I'm the uncle to this one, I'm this, and so on, you know, etc. They might be allowed in. But in the marriage supper of the Lamb celebration, it would be impossible for anyone to sneak in there without being invited. There'll be no gate crashing. Mighty angels will be there, as it were, serving the guests. So the point is that there'll be those that are invited, who'll be there at the marriage supper of the Lamb. And it says, blessed are those who'll be invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. Of course, we know that the groom is the Lord Jesus Christ, in this case, and the bride is the church. It's all believers who come to know Christ as personal Savior. They form the bride of Christ. So it will be Christ and his bride, the church. And of course, the angels will be there. Now, the only hope for anyone of us to have or to be sure that you'll be invited, you'll be there at that event, is to have a special relationship with Christ before you die, in this period in which we are living. Remember again that custom of the Jewish marriage tradition. The first stage was entering into a contract between the bride and the groom, and then they had that long period of courtship. So similarly here, for one to be found at the marriage supper of the Lamb on that day, you must have a contract with Christ. You must have a relationship with him. He must know you. You must know him personally. And you know, the good news is that we're still in that period when the Lord Jesus Christ, as it were, is ready to sign contracts with those who will come to him in faith. And God the Father has facilitated for this, that you and me, lost in sin, can be saved today and enter into a relationship with Christ. So that on that great day, when his wedding takes place, you'll be among the invited. You'll be there because you'll be part of the bride. And just remind us of a few scriptures concerning what God has done to make it possible for you and me to actually enter into a relationship with Christ today, and therefore be guaranteed of being there on that last day. Well known verse, John chapter 3, verse 16, "For God so loved the world, he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." Another scripture, John 1, from verse 10 to 13. It says, "He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or husband's will, but born of God." Lastly, another scripture, John chapter 3, verse 35 and 36. It says, "The Father loves the Son and has placed everything in his hands." Now listen. "Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. But whoever rejects the Son will not see life, for God's wrath remains on him." So the way to be sure that you can be there, be present at the wedding of the Lamb, is to believe in Christ, as what you've just read has demonstrated to us from the Bible. Believe in Christ, receive him in your life, and become a child of God, or what we call be born again. Then you start a special relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. And in a manner of speaking, he signs a contract with you that guarantees your presence on that great day, the last wedding that earth and heaven will ever witness. Indeed, become part of the bride, the church, and therefore be at the center, in fact, of that great event. Here now, we can enter in this courtship with Christ, our Savior. We can enjoy his presence and fellowship today, knowing that in future, that last day, when the wedding place takes place, our love with Christ will be consummated. So my dear friend, let me ask you a question. Will you be one of those invited for the wedding supper of the Lamb? The gospel when it's preached is a general invitation to consider as if you are signing a contract with Christ. So will you respond to that general invitation? The second observation I'd like to make concerning this marriage supper of the Lamb is the designation or title given to the bridegroom. He is called the Lamb, the wedding supper of the Lamb. Why is he called the Lamb? Well, in my estimation, Christ, this term or title Lamb, summarizes the mission for which he came when he came in the world the first time. John the Baptist once saw Christ walking, and he was with his disciples, and he said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." So Christ is called the Lamb because he came to lay down his life as a ransom, as a payment for the sin of many, for your sins and my sins. In other words, Christ came to pay his life as dowry for the bride. as Lobola for the bride. He paid with his own life to win the church to himself, to win sinners to himself. His blood was shed on Calvary's tree so that we, when we believe upon him, our sins being washed away, we become part of that church that he came to die for, the bride. We see, for example, in the book of Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25 to 27, it says, "Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ loved the church, and he gave himself for her, that he might sanctify her and cleanse her with the washing of water by the word, that he might present her to himself as a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish." He gave himself for her to wash her clean of her sins. So at that last day, at the wedding, he will present the church to himself without spot, without wrinkle, without any blemish. She'll be glorious, holy and without blemish, the Bible says. When the Lamb weds his bride, he'll have accomplished the work he came to do as the Lamb of God. Tukiya looks great, dressed in this immaculate dress today, well adorned. And it's a reflection of how the church will look on that day. There before the Lamb will be his bride, a great multitude, the Bible tells us, which no man can number. The bride will be dressed immaculately. She's ready, the Bible says what we read there. It says, dressed and red in fine linen, clean and bright, truly adorned for her husband, the Lamb. Every single one of us will be there, forming the bride. The church will have been washed clean by the blood of the Lamb. Our dress will be righteousness, will be holiness, will be purity. In this vision, John saw in chapter 19 of Revelation, we are just given a small glimpse of how the bride will look like. But when you go further in that book, chapter 21, 22, and so on, we see even more glorious picture concerning the church. One that stands out to me so wonderfully, it says, she will shine with the glory of God. She will shine with the glory of God, like the sun, utterly glorified and marvelous. All this is because the Lamb laid down his life for his bride. He shed his blood. What a bridegroom. What a great love for his bride did the Lord Jesus Christ demonstrate and show. He died to win his bride. My friend, has Christ won you with his love? Have you accepted him and received a new life as your Savior? Have you seen him as the Lamb of God who takes away even your sins? Without this, you will not be at the wedding feast of the Lamb. Without this, you cannot be at the wedding feast of the Lamb. And so you will not be one of those who are invited. In fact, worse still, you'll be cast out from that blessed company. You know, there is a parable in the Gospels about a wedding. And people gathered in this wedding hall, and the parable says that the owner of that particular event or the wedding noticed that there was somebody in the congregation who was not dressed in the attire for the guests. He went and confronted him and said, "Friend, how did you find yourself here?" And the man was speechless. He could not say anything. Then he ordered his servants, bind him legs, feet, and hands, and cast him out in the outer darkness, where they suffer forever. It's a picture of how those who have not believed in Christ, at that last day, when the wedding supper of the Lamb is called, how they shall be consigned away in outer darkness forever. So if you don't believe in Christ, by the time you breathe your last, you'll experience what that parable warns us about, casting out. But the bride, those who believe in Christ, will be there with the Lamb, because they will have been washed by his blood. The third observation quickly, which we see in this verse, or in these verses, it says, right, blessed are those who are called to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said to me, these are the true sayings of God. So thirdly, we see that these people, they invited, God blessed. Blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. Their blessedness comprises in many wonderful realities. We don't have time to go into much of this, but just to mention some of the blessings that the bride of Christ will experience on that day, and indeed going forward. Firstly, they will see the face of the groom. They will see the face of the groom. He is God. He is the most blessed person, full of grace and truth, the Bible tells us. And it declares that those who have believed in him shall see his face. His face shines with eternal glory. You may recall that account in the Gospels again, when Peter, John, and James were taken to the mountain with the Lord Jesus Christ. And there before them, he was transfigured. He began to shine like the sun, giving a glimpse of his glory when he was transfigured before those three apostles. Now, at this wedding feast, in his full splendor and majesty, the invited will behold him. What a sight it will be to see the face of the groom. Secondly, they will be like him. The Bible says, we don't know how he shall be, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Seeing Jesus will be the most transforming experience ever known by man. Indeed, God has predestined that his people, his bride, the bride for his son, be conformed to the image of his son. Christ-likeness, in other words, which we deeply long for as believers here below, shall now be fully realized and attained. We shall be like him, both inwardly and outwardly. We shall be transformed. The Bible says this, for example, in Philippians chapter 3, verse 20, that he will transform our lowly bodies to be like his glorious body. So we too shall shine with his glory. We shall be transformed. What a blessing to be like him. But that's a blessing of those who will be there as the bride. Thirdly, they will engage in joyful worship. That passage I read is hallelujah. For the Lord God Almighty reigns. Let us rejoice. For the Lord God Omnipotent reigns. Let us be glad and rejoice and give him glory. For the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. So there's rejoicing, worship, and adulterated worship. The whole of heaven is rejoicing. All the attendants are full of joy, unspeakable and full of glory. What a blessed company to be, engaging in joyful worship. Thirdly, another blessing is to share in the riches of Christ. The Bible declares that Christ has unsearchable riches. No one can fathom the riches of Christ. But his bride, in her joy, will enter in this blessing because she now is united with him, and all his riches and glory will be hers as well. Now let's just imagine for a moment that Chisengele was a billionaire, not in kwacha terms, but in serious money terms, a billionaire. And having pronounced husband and wife, Tukiya would have been a billionaire instantly. Instantly. Because now when you marry, you share everything. We heard in the vows, my worldly goods I share with you. Everything you have comes into common ownership between husband and wife. Now imagine Christ, the inheritor of all things, the King of Kings, the Son of God, marrying his bride, the church. She will enter into this inheritance. She's actually, the Bible again tells us, a joint heir with Christ. Everything he owns, he will share with his bride. So it's a great blessing to share the riches of Christ with the church. So the bride will share in Christ's infinite riches, and this will be truly wonderful. But lastly, not least, about how they'll be blessed, is that this status will be forever. The blessed state entered into at the marriage supper of the Lamb will be eternal. Chisengele and Tukiya, we don't know how many years God will bless you with, but we pray there'll be many, 40, 50, 60, 70 years of marriage, God willing. But one day, your union will come to an end. One of you may depart. Some of us are nearer there than you. Life here on earth is temporal. However good it may be, it comes to an end, and we must all depart. As the Bible puts it, we go the way of the earth. But at the wedding supper of the Lamb, once Christ marries his bride, as I said at the beginning, a new era is ushered in, a new heaven and a new earth, eternal in existence. And so all these blessings that the bride will enter into with her husband, the Lamb, the bridegroom, be forever and ever. On and on and on, the bliss continues. Glorious indeed. So the Bible wants us to see these things and look forward to that marriage supper of the Lamb. That's why it says, blessed are those who are invited. There could be many more I could say, but time doesn't allow us. But again, the question, my friend, is, will you be there? Would you be part of this inheritance, this heirship, this entry into riches and it all? And we have said before already how we can enter into this is by believing in the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'm sure that Chisengele and Tukiya would be so delighted if their wedding today becomes the occasion on which you can close in with Christ, become a believer, become a Christian, that you too can enter into this relationship with Christ, so that they will see you on that day at the wedding supper of the Lamb. You'll be there to enjoy forever and ever with them. But fourthly, in terms of reflecting on this passage in whole, and this is my last point, is that the wedding supper of the Lamb is assured. It will take place. Now, until a few minutes ago, we could not really say concerning the wedding of Chisengele and Tukiya that it's guaranteed. Come hell and storm, it will take place. We can't say that. We couldn't say that. Because, you know, life happens. Things happen on earth. There's nothing guaranteed. Okay? But in their case, so we could always be saying, for example, in a month before, 2 weeks before, even a few days before, God willing, they will marry on 14th of May, 2022 at Osaka Baptist Church. God willing. It was appropriate to say that because none of us is in control of our lives. But about the wedding supper of the Lamb, we cannot say those words, God willing. He is willing, it will take place. How do we know that? The passage says, the angel told the Apostle John, write. Write. John wrote down that this is going to take place. So what God has caused to be written on a record cannot fail to happen. If it's in this book, the Bible, it is sealed and guaranteed. The Lord Jesus Christ said, heaven and earth may pass away. In fact, who will pass away? But not an iota of my words will pass away till everything is fulfilled. And then he says at the end, the angel at the end says this, and he said to me, these are the true words of God. So the angel is telling the Apostle John, what I'm passing on to you, Apostle John, are words of God, are words from God. God cannot lie. God binds himself to his word. What he has promised, he will deliver. He's almighty, all wise. Nothing can thwart his purposes. He says these are the true words of God. Of course, this supper, marriage supper of the Lamb, will be preceded, as we know from Scripture, with the Lord Jesus Christ first coming to collect his bride, just like the Jewish custom. The bridegroom with his friends will go in the night to collect the bride and take her to his home, and then the wedding takes place and celebrations and so on. Christ, like manner, will come. We don't know whether it will be during the day or at night. We're not told in the Scripture, but he will come to collect his bride. And then that marriage supper would take place in like manner. He said to his disciples, in my Father's house, there are many rooms. I go and prepare a place for you. I'll come back and take you. So that where I am, you will also be there. And the Bible further says, the Son of Man will appear with great power and glory, accompanied by the angels who will gather his bride from all corners of the earth. And Paul says these words to the Thessalonians. He says, for the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together in the clouds and meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. So Christ will come a second time to collect his bride and to usher in, as it were, this wedding and an eternal existence with the saints forever and ever. As I said, totally a new era, new heaven and a new earth, where only righteousness dwells. So again, the question is, will you be there? This is guaranteed. This is assured. It's written in the scriptures. These are words of God. Nothing can change it. It will be there. So for the believers, we rejoice because we know and we can look forward to that event taking place. And we can say, by the grace of God, I shall be there. He saved me, not because I'm cleverer than other people, but by his own grace and mercy, he saved me. So again, I'm sure Chisengele and Tukiya will be so delighted if all of us in this auditorium this morning would be there on that day when Christ comes to collect his bride, because we'll have believed in him, we'll have had a relationship with him, we'll have had, as it were, a contract with him, and that looking forward to the marriage supper of the Lamb. So as I end, may I just say this, that may the Lord grant a grace to all of us, that these words of this marriage supper of the Lamb will cause us to think and reflect and ask whether we are ready for that supper, because it will take place, and blessed are those who are invited. Amen.
Yeah, I would like to invite the couple to come with me to the vestry to sign the marriage certificate. They can be accompanied by their witnesses. Please come. Is Mumamba here? Mumamba. It's open.
Good morning, everyone. While we wait for the couple, just some quick announcements to guide us as we'll be leaving shortly. Please retain your seats as the couple and the wedding party exit. You'll be ushered out. The couple would like to greet everyone, and so if you don't have to hurry out anywhere, please follow the ushers' instructions to the back entrance, so the main entrance at the back, and then you'll be able to greet the couple through there. In line with COVID regulations, we've been asked to just announce that please no hugging and handshaking if you can, but please share your greetings with them all the same. And then we'll be also sharing some refreshments afterwards, so just some drinks will be served. Once again, if you don't have to rush out anywhere, please stay to share a drink or two with us. And then I'll ask that we remain seated as we sing together number 70 from the Grace Supplement, that God should love a sinner such as I.
That God should love a sinner such as I should yearn to change my sorrow into bliss, no rest. had planned to bring me nigh. How wonderful is love like this! Such love,
such love,
such wondrous love,
such love,
such wondrous love, that God should love a sinner such as I. How wonderful is love! Such wondrous love, such love, such wondrous love, that God should love a sinner such as I. How wonderful is love like this, that poor, a willful outcast such as I, the Father Lamb, the Savior, bled and died redemption for a worthless slave to buy, who long had law and grace divine. Such love, such wondrous love, such love, such wondrous love, that God should love the sinner such as I. How wonderful is love like this! And now he takes me to his heart a son. He asks me not to fill a servant's place. The far off country wanderings old are done. Wide open are his arms of grace. Such love, such wondrous love, such love, such wondrous love, that God should love a sinner such as I. How wonderful is love like this!
We want to find out what was happening where we went. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to introduce to you the newest couple at Lusaka Baptist Church, Mr. and Mrs. Chibuta.
Found by you.
Sangalala lelo timawanga. For this is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it.
Hey! Why should you worry? Why should you stress yourself, my friend? God is your daddy. He will supply all of your needs. And when I say that his love for you unconditional, hear me clearly, 'cause his plans for you are so beautiful. But the
enemy, enemy. He wants to get the best of me, best of me. Said the enemy, enemy. He wants to get the best of me, best of me. But I say no, oh, oh. This is my joy, oh, boy. I will not let go, I will say. Sangalala lelo, mtimawanga. Sangalala lelo, mtimawanga. For this is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it.
From ashes to a winner, while I was yet a sinner, still he was there for me. So sangalala lelo, ntima wanga. Sangalala lelo, ntima wanga. For this is the day that the Lord has made, and I will rejoice and be glad in it.
This is the day that the Lord has made.